Well, good morning and very warm welcome to All Saints Guildford and our morning service of worship. Once again, we find ourselves locked down and unable to meet together face to face, and that's a sadness for all of us. But I'm delighted that we can be together online in this way and worship together. And I pray that in our service today, we will find the Lord's comfort, his guidance, his blessing and his companionship once again. Today, our service is focused around Jesus' baptism in the River Jordan and those extraordinary words of God the Father, "You are my Son whom I love, with you I am well pleased." And we'll be thinking about what it means to be known and loved by God this morning. And so as our worship begins, we say together the opening greeting. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Give us the joy of your saving help and sustain us with your life-giving spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
And so we come to a time of confession. In a moment of stillness and quiet, we allow and invite the Holy Spirit to move among us, to search our hearts and minds. As we come into God's presence at the beginning of a new year, we bring with us many different thoughts and emotions, hope for a fresh start and a better year ahead, maybe anxiety at what the months ahead will hold, perhaps the desire to put old ways behind us and to start afresh, maybe the desire to learn from past mistakes and to go deeper in faith. Let's take a moment to be still. We say the confession together. God our Father, we come to you in sorrow for our sins, for turning away from you and ignoring your will for our lives. Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For behaving just as we wish without thinking of you, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For failing you by what we do and think and say, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For letting ourselves be drawn away from you by temptations in the world about us, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For living as if we were ashamed to belong to your Son, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. And so may the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the collect for today, the first Sunday of Epiphany. Heavenly Father, at the Jordan you revealed Jesus as your Son. May we recognise him as our Lord and know ourselves to be your beloved children through Jesus Christ our Saviour. Amen.
Well, here we are again at the beginning of another proper lockdown. And I wonder how you're feeling. It's not easy, is it? The thought of not being able to go out, not being able to meet up with friends, not being able to go to school, and just not being able to do all the things that we could normally do. Today's service will be focusing on the baptism of Jesus. And I was wondering whether there was anything that we could learn from this event in Jesus's life, which might help us through the difficulties we're facing at present. Let's think about what happened. Can you picture the scene? There's a large crowd down by a river. It's a big river, the River Jordan. And there, standing in the water, is a man. His name is John, and he's dressed rather strangely in a garment made of camel's hair. He's calling out to the people gathered around, "Turn from your wicked ways," he's saying. "Say sorry for all the things that you've done wrong. Start to live better lives. Repent and come and be baptized as a sign that you want to change." People go forward to be baptized in the river. Then from out of the crowd comes Jesus. He's coming forward to be baptized. But hang on a minute. Jesus hasn't done anything wrong. Does he need to be baptized? Well, John clearly doesn't think so. "No, no," says John. "I'm not worthy to baptize you. You should baptize me." But Jesus insists that it's right for him to be baptized. And so John takes Jesus and lowers him into the water and baptizes him. Then something amazing happens. As Jesus comes up out of the water, the Holy Spirit, in the form of a dove, comes down from heaven onto him. And then a voice, God's voice, speaks these words over Jesus. You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased. How incredible. And how must Jesus have felt? Well, I guess he would feel just like you or I feel when somebody speaks things like that over us, telling us that they love us and are proud of us. Immediately after this, Jesus went out into the desert for 40 days. He spent all those days by himself, in isolation, isolated from family and friends. And I feel sure that remembering those words, you are my son, I love you, I'm pleased with you, must have helped to sustain him through those difficult days. Which brings me back to what we're living through at the moment. We too share that loving Heavenly Father who spoke those words of affirmation over Jesus at his baptism. And he longs to comfort, reassure, encourage, and help us also. The Bible is full of passages and verses which remind us of this. For me, at the moment, I find Psalm 46 particularly helpful. Here are just a few of the verses. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Be still and know that I am God. Just imagine God being there for us whenever we're in trouble, being able to run to him for protection and as a refuge when we're feeling scared, and being able to draw strength from him when we're feeling weak. Another verse that I came across just recently helps me to understand just how much God loves me and wants to carry me through difficult times. These verses are from Isaiah, and they're talking about God being our shepherd. This is what they say. He gathers the lambs, that's me and that's you. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. If being reminded of these verses would help you too, then I've made them into bookmarks that you could colour in if you like. And you could keep them close by and look at them whenever you feel a bit uncertain or worried. You can download them from the church website. I do hope you'll find them helpful.
A reading from Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 to 5. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and the darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This is a reading from Acts, chapter 19, verses 1 to 7. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul passed through the inland regions and came to Ephesus, where he found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became believers?" They replied, "No, we've not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" They answered, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him, that is, in Jesus." On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. Altogether, there were about 12 of them. This is the word of the Lord.
And our gospel reading for this morning, Mark chapter 1. And so John came, baptizing in the desert region and preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel's hair, with a leather belt round his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message: after me will come one more powerful than I, the thongs of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. As Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Well, I wonder whether you've ever had an epiphany moment, a moment when the penny drops and something suddenly becomes clear to you. Maybe it's an answer to a crossword clue, or the solution to a problem that you've been wrestling with for some time. Maybe it's a flash of insight into where you left something you'd lost, probably your car keys. It's a moment of sudden realisation or discovery. Well, those epiphany moments come in much more significant ways too. It might be the moment we met the person who we later married, or we were offered a university place or a job that opened up a whole new world to us. When we look back, we remember that that was the moment something really significant happened, something we might not have planned for ourselves. But the deepest meaning of the word epiphany is spiritual. It describes a meeting with God that changes our life forever. And that, I think, is what is happening for Jesus on the occasion of his baptism. John the Baptist was out in the region of the Jordan River preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And crowds of people of all kinds were coming to him to be baptized and to hear his challenging message. And there was clearly a sense of anticipation and expectation. Could this be the long-awaited Messiah? Was this the Christ? But John makes things clear. He's just the forerunner, the one who prepares the way. One much more powerful than him was coming, who would baptize with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Then, in the midst of the crowd and the noise, Jesus comes to John for baptism. Mark, in our gospel reading for this morning, records it very simply. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan River. It reads like a common event. Jesus was just one of the crowd coming to John in repentance and faith. But something happens that will transform his life forever, the epiphany moment, if you like. We read that as Jesus was praying, heaven was opened and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son whom I love, with you I am well pleased." What extraordinary words. Well, it was an extraordinary moment altogether. It's one of the very few moments in the Gospels where we see the Trinity revealed. God the Father speaks those wonderful words over Jesus the Son, while the Holy Spirit descends in a way that was recognisable. Father, Son and Holy Spirit, the great revelation of who God is. And for Jesus, that was a defining moment in his life, the moment that launched his ministry. And it was out of that experience that he found the wisdom and the strength to fulfil his calling. Well, I find it interesting the elements that make up that epiphany experience for Jesus. The first, I think, is obedience. Luke records it in this way. When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. It was a simple obedience to God's call. Nothing spectacular at that point, just a willingness to do the right thing. That's important for us in our Christian lives, the need for a simple obedience to God. That might mean being baptized ourselves or bringing our children for baptism, a simple statement of faith that marks us out as Christians. It means coming to church week by week, placing our lives in God's hands and seeking him through the words and the sacrament of the service. It simply means doing the right thing, being faithful to our families, consistent in our work, honest in our speaking, loving in our actions. Obedience to God is nothing flashy, but it puts us in a place where God can meet us, a place where God can reveal himself to us. Well, the second element in Jesus' Epiphany moment, I think, was prayer. Luke records, as Jesus was praying, the heavens were opened. Jesus, of course, was a person of prayer, getting up early often, going to quiet places, keeping in touch with God, his Father. And we too need to be people of prayer. We need to set aside time on our own each day to read the Bible and pray consistently for our families, our friends, our colleagues, our neighbours, the world in which we live. We need to set aside time to pray together as a church family. I think there's never been a more important time than this to do that. We're meeting four mornings a week for morning prayer during this lockdown at 9:15 a.m. via Zoom. And it'd be wonderful if each of us could set aside 25 minutes, say one morning a week, to come and pray. We need to pray together during our Sunday services. We need to pray during the quiet moments of our days. Archbishop William Temple said, "When I pray, coincidences happen. When I don't, they don't." God hears, he answers, however feeble and faltering our prayers might seem to us. The third element, I think, in Jesus' Epiphany moment is the coming of the Holy Spirit. The Gospel writers tell us the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. Something happened that was visible enough for them to record, and recognisably the Spirit of God. And that happens often in the New Testament, and it comes in our reading from the Acts of the Apostles for this morning. When Paul was in Ephesus, he met some disciples who had been baptised by John the Baptist. John the Baptist had told them to believe in the one who was coming after him, the one whose sandals he was not worthy to untie. And now Paul tells them about Jesus, the one who would baptise with the Holy Spirit. And as Paul lays his hands on those disciples and prays for them, the Holy Spirit comes and they speak prophetic words. The Spirit came in a way that was tangible and recordable. And through the coming of the Holy Spirit, Jesus was empowered to begin his work and ministry. And that same Spirit is available to us today as we seek to continue Jesus' work and ministry in our own times. And then finally, Jesus hears the words of God the Father, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." I think they're extraordinary words. I wonder whether anyone has ever spoken such words about you. Was a parent able to express their feelings in that way? And what difference would it have made to your life if they had? Words are really powerful for good and for evil. And these words defined Jesus' identity and equipped him for the momentousness of the task that lay ahead. Obedience, prayer, the power of the Spirit and the words of God, together they enabled an epiphany for Jesus. So what might that mean for us at the beginning of 2021? With the challenges that we face in the year ahead. What do we hope for? What do we long for as this new year begins? Maybe we have a sense that we need to draw closer to God, to know him better, to seek his blessing in our lives and in the world. So much that we took for granted has changed over the course of the year. Life seems fragile and hard to navigate. I think like Jesus at his baptism, we need to hear God's words to us, to know the presence of his Spirit in our lives. Through obedience and prayer, let's put ourselves in a place where God can come close to us through his Spirit. And it may be at the beginning of this new year that the Lord is calling us to step up or to step out in faith in new ways. That might mean baptism or confirmation, making a public commitment of faith in these challenging times. It might mean stepping up to take new responsibility in our workplaces, in our local community, here at All Saints. In the next few weeks, we'll be looking for new members of our PCC who will take responsibility for leading our church in the coming years. Particularly, we're looking for a new church warden to replace Carolyn when she steps down after 5 years of hard and serious work. The role of warden, you may know, is one of senior leadership in our church, sharing responsibility for the life of the church with myself and Henrietta and Trish. And if you sense the Lord might be calling you to either of those roles as a PCC member or a warden, then please do let me know. Maybe there are other ways you'd like to serve here at All Saints, through music, through preaching, with our children and young people, or as part of one of our vision groups. Do let me know if you'd like to step into new roles or to step up into new things in this coming year. And so today, as we remember Jesus' baptism, that extraordinary epiphany moment, let's remember again those beautiful words of God the Father: "You are my Son whom I love. With you I am well pleased." And I pray today and in this year ahead that we'll know ourselves loved by God and have the grace to respond to his call in obedience and faith. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so let us declare our faith in God. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us and rose again? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? We believe and trust in him. This is the faith of the church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us now pray together to our Heavenly Father, who has adopted us through baptism as his own children. Loving Father, we pray for your church and for Christians throughout the world. Where they are in a minority, let them find strength in knowing you are with them. And where they are persecuted, let them find courage to continue in faithful service. We pray for Bishop Andrew and all who have a ministry of leadership in our diocese. We pray for members of the Bishop's Council and the Diocesan Board of Finance, as they balance issues of mission and finance. Also in our prayers are those serving on the Diocesan Synod and those from this diocese serving on the General Synod. For Peter Coles in his role as Diocesan Secretary and for Chris Ellis in his role as Deputy Diocesan Secretary. In the Anglican Circle of Prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church in New Zealand and Polynesia. May the Spirit of God strengthen and uphold us so that we live Christian lives in the light of God's love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all understanding, you have promised to give wisdom to anyone who asks. As we walk through life, give us wisdom and understanding in every decision we make. Guide our thoughts and direct our steps. When we experience uncertainty and confusion, may we lean on your limitless wisdom. May your divine Holy Spirit be at work in us, like a lamp to our feet and a shield to our minds. Help us to think clearly and calmly. Help us to act with confidence and wisdom. Help us to glorify you in everything we do. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
A prayer for the world. God of love and hope, you make the world and care for all creations, but the world feels strange right now. The news is full of stories about coronavirus. Some people are worried that they might get ill. Others are anxious for their family and friends. Be with them and help them to find peace. We pray for the doctors and nurses and scientists and all those who are working to discover the right medicines to help those who are ill. We are so thankful to those who have developed these vaccines, and we pray that they can be distributed quickly to those who need them most. Thank you that even in these anxious times you are with us. Help us to put our trust into you and keep us safe. Lord, our mercy, hear our prayer.
We hold in your presence all who are being cared for in this parish, and we thank you for the care and dedication of those caring for them. We name before you all those with particular needs who have asked for our prayers, especially Sheila, Julie, Rebecca, Marion, Pauline, Penny, Doris, Joy, Pat, Jeff, and Mike. Also, the family and friends of Brian Phillips, Joseph Park, and Lillian Bottomley, whose anniversary of death is at this time. May they know your presence with them, and that you are their strength, their healing, and their salvation. We pray especially for those who live and work in Hedgeway, Henley Bank, Highview Road, and Hollow Close, and our mission partners, the Kearns family in Papua New Guinea. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
And so a few notices for the coming week. Our pastoral team meets tomorrow morning, led by Marguerite Barclay, and that of course will be via Zoom. The standing committee meets on Tuesday evening this week, followed on Wednesday evening by our pilgrim course. We've just begun the fourth in the series, looking at Jesus' Beatitudes. Thursday, late afternoon, our worship vision group meets. And then very importantly, on Saturday evening, we're having a Burns Night quiz, a quiz with a Scottish flavour. Robin will be our host again, and please do let Eve know if you would like to sign up for that. As we mentioned before, morning prayer continues Monday to Thursday at 9:15 via Zoom. And please do make a priority of coming, maybe just once a week, to pray together in these very challenging days. Services during January will be online only due to the coronavirus, but the PCC will review that later in the month, and we'll be in touch to let you know how things develop. And finally, do join us for Zoom coffee after the service at 11:30. Everyone is welcome.
Thank you.
And our final blessing for today. May the Father, from whom every family in earth and heaven receives its name, strengthen you with his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.